tell the story of Infinity War without Adam Warlock. I mean, there he is, smack in the middle of the cover. It seems inconceivable, right? Or at least to those of us who are familiar with the story, which, truth be told, aren't that many. Even most comic book readers today have never gone back and read Infinity War. It's one of those old school stories where you have to be an old school fan or a comic book aficionado to be familiar with, which is what Kevin Feige is, and that's why he drudged this thing up and he dusted it off and he's going to make it his new Avengers double feature. But I worry about pulling somebody, such an integral figure out of a storyline, because you might recall that we asked ourselves, us hardcore comic book fans, a similar question when it came to Ultron and Hank Pym not so long ago. And I think that while it worked to some extent, and people who weren't familiar with Ultron's origin in the comics never knew that Hank Pym was missing from the story, for those of us who do know about, you know, how it originally went down in the comics, I think that the gravitas and the message wasn't there in the MCU version of the Ultron story. So we'll see how Avengers Infinity War turns out. More likely than not, it's another toy for Tony. And Hank Pym, interestingly enough, did eventually join the MCU, and Adam Warlock is coming up. And it's weird that they would join the MCU at a later date after their signature storylines took place. In fact, James Gunn has said he planned to put Adam Warlock in Volume 2, but decided ultimately against it because there wasn't enough room in the movie. It was too crowded. And I can see that. But I also can see Kevin Feige saying, don't you dare introduce him because I'm not using him in Infinity War. I don't want to hear about it from a bunch of comic book fans. So let's just use him later. And oops, oh well, he missed his signature storyline. But I have to say, though, even though Adam Warlock isn't going to be a part of Infinity War, the way Volume 3 is shaping up, based on Volume 2 and the end credit teases, he's going to get a pretty darn good story anyway. So, yes, we've had now two Adam Warlock cocoon sightings. The first at the end of Volume 1, part of the Collector's Collection, and that ended up being a false start for the character. But now he shows up again in another end credit sequence where Ayesha reveals that she has created the perfect man, and she shall call him Adam. That's a very concrete Adam Warlock tease, whereas the other one, they could get away with it, right? I mean, nobody actually referenced it, but I think James Gunn has built himself some nice insurance that he's definitely gonna get to use Adam Warlock in Volume 3. And that's what we're gonna talk about in this video. What's gonna happen in Volume 3 based on what happened in Volume 2, and also based on what we know about Adam Warlock, and James Gunn at this point is a filmmaker. I think he really came into focus with Volume 2 because he was surprisingly emotional, surprisingly straightforward. And on that note, I think he makes it really clear where he's going with Volume 3. And I think it's really exciting. So as I said, it's obvious. And the most obvious thing is that he will be the villain of Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 3, sent after the team to get the revenge that the Sovereign so desperately want for Rocket Raccoon stealing their batteries. Yeah, it seems like a small slight, but it's really stuck with the Sovereign. And I guess third time's the charm. But I put villain in quotation marks because obviously at the end, again, obviously, by the end of the movie, Adam Warlock will decide he likes the Guardians of the Galaxy and become a member of the team, as he has so famously done in the comics. He's actually one of the most famous members of the Guardians of the Galaxy. But then again, just because it happened in the comics doesn't mean it has to happen in the movies. But I think this can happen organically, and hey, you gotta give him one of the two, right? You can't steal the Infinity Gauntlet from him and being a member of the Guardians of the Galaxy, right? Right, Kevin Feige? All right, so I also think it's obvious that when this, Ayesha's self-proclaimed perfect man clashes with the Guardians of the Galaxy, two things will happen, right? Very obvious. Number one, he will, and I guess, you know, part of the struggle for James Gunn is making this seem fresh and exciting as it happens, even though it's really clear. I guess, you know, I wouldn't call this predictable. I would call it coming together in a very exciting way that I can't wait to see. I want to put it in that light. So anyway, number one, he will learn that being perfect isn't all it's cracked up to be, and that the best way to live is to embrace your inner right? So that's number one. Then number two, oh boy, Love triangle. Oh, you know it's coming now that I've told you about it because it makes such obvious sense. So they finally pushed Peter and Gamora right to the edge of going from won't they to will they, right, as a couple. So you know what happens next? It's right out of the playbook for rom-coms. Well, actually, you know, James Gunn made the Cheers reference in the movie, so they're going by sitcom rules. So just as they're about to hook up, you got to put the competition in there. And I think Adam Warlock would be wonderful competition. First off, because Gamora would, I think, obviously be attracted to him. He has discipline, intellect, and he has repressed emotions, right? I mean, that sounds like Gamora's perfect man. And there would also be an interesting discussion about, is it best to be in love with someone like, what's the best partner? Someone exactly like yourself? I think Adam Warlock's going to be a great fighter, too, so I can't wait to see him go up against the Guardians. But also someone who's... you know, someone like yourself emotionally too, or someone who's the opposite. You know, opposites attract. Peter Quill loves his pop culture references. I don't think he got to Paula Abdul, but maybe when he got that views, that song is on there. So that can help him out, right? And so he can use that as a way to counteract Drax saying that it'll never work. And then also, the other reason I think this is a good idea for a love triangle is that while Chris Pratt is famous for his rugged looks, his rugged good looks, he's not a classic pretty boy. So if you cast a classic pretty boy as Adam Warlock, dip him in gold, you can just let all of Star-Lord's insecurities bubble to the surface. I think it would be fun to watch, like very funny, very, it would be something great for Chris Pratt to play with. And I think that a lot of people would be, and it would be great for guys to be able to relate to a someone who, well, you know, Chris Pratt's Star-Lord is supposed to be oh so sexy. You know, it's a role that made him famous partially because he's supposed to be so good looking in it. So I think for him to have that self-doubt would, you know, make him very relatable. It would be a great direction to go in with the character. And he was kind of sidelined in Volume 2. So this would be a good way to put him back in the spotlight. I loves it. Now, there's a basis in the comics for Adam Warlock and Gamora getting along because they were very good friends in the comics. They had adventures together, they fought together, they even died together. So that history is there. Adam Warlock also has another BFF named Pip, which is basically a teleporting Tyrion Lannister. And I can see, you know, maybe James Gunn wanting to put such a character into the MCU, but why do it when he would just take screen time away from another lovable, miniature, debauched loudmouth that we've already got, right? Also, I don't think, speaking of what James Gunn will and will not do, I don't think he can resist the fact that Adam Warlock was inspired by Jesus Christ Superstar, the musical. That is an amazing bit of information to run with for James Gunn on multiple levels. So in the comics, Adam Warlock was, so he was inspired by this musical, and so he was supposed to be a superhero savior, and many of his early stories have biblical influences. That's amazing. So you have a musical component, which of course James Gunn is all about, right? With not only the Jesus Christ Superstar musical, but religious music in general, right? Religious music played at houses of worship, but also there's so much religion in rock and roll, right? I mean, it's something that singers have been inspired to do songs about forever, right? So that's fantastic. Then also, Ayesha says that this is the perfect man, right? So he would be the sovereign, and he would take on like a Jesus Christ sensibility, a selflessness. So how interesting it would be to see that clash with the selfishness of the Guardians of the Galaxy, right? Their selfishness coming up against basically Space Jesus. Ah, Space Jesus. I hope somebody calls him Space Jesus. That's a really strong selling point. And then also, speaking of Jesus, the visuals. Oh, the visuals. They could do some really interesting stuff there. Yeah, I think this is going to be hard for James Gunn to resist. Now, speaking of gods, capital and lowercase, Peter Quill just dealt with the reveal of his heritage and the sacrifice of his celestial half. So now he's just a regular human. And that could lead to some really interesting self-reflection and conversation, perhaps with Adam Warlock, about godhood, right? And how important it is and what it does and what it allows someone to do. Well, would there be maybe some god envy, right? Where Gamora's like, that man's basically a god. He's Space Jesus. And Peter was like, oh, I was just a god and I just gave it up. Wow, man, this timing couldn't be worse. It's also pretty bad timing for Infinity War. But anyway, I digress. So then also, Adam Warlock, speaking of Infinity War, has a long history with the Soul Gem, which could be available by the time Volume 3 rolls around. But you know what? As you can see, this is already so rich as it is. Why complicate it with the Soul Stone? I don't think it's necessary. As for his power set, if you're wondering, Adam Warlock has traditional energy manipulation powers. You see it all the time in comics. In his case, it's cosmic energy. He fires blasts, he can throw up force fields, he's able to fly, and also that cocoon, it doesn't just birth him, but he can go back and heal in it and also use it for protection. And in the comics, he can self-generate it. So we'll see if that's the case. I mean, it looked self-generating when the collector had it, but it didn't. It looked, you know, sovereign made when we saw it at the end of Volume 2. So besides Gamora and Star-Lord and the love triangle that's going to create, who else will go up against Adam Warlock? Well, Teen Groot, he's introduced in one of the end credit scenes of Volume 2. And while he's very funny, my guess is that the Russo brothers have called maybe dibs on him and he'll be Teen Groot in Infinity War. And then by the time we get back to Volume 3, he'll be all grown again. He'll be grown up. Then Drax is still around, and I think he may or may not have a crush on Mantis. I don't even think he knows if he has a crush on Mantis. Although, I totally think that Mantis and Kraglin, a.k.a. Sean Gunn, are the perfect couple. And Kraglin is also a member of the team now, having inherited Yondu's arrow and Mohawk. I'm sure he'll be better with it by the next movie. I also wonder if Kraglin will show up in Infinity War. That's going to be, they said it was going to be a crowded movie, but it seems now super crowded. Then Rocket Raccoon will be there as well, and it would be great to see more of him and Groot. I missed that a little bit in this movie. It was there, but it wasn't the same as in Volume 1. And then also, I'd be very interested to see how he would react to Adam Warlock, because first of all, both are genetically engineered, so there's some common ground there. But also, how would Rocket Raccoon react to finding religion? How would all the Guardians of the Galaxy react to finding religion? Being presented with that option, that path to walk down. I think Drax could be tempted as well, considering how much he's lost. He seems pretty okay, considering that he lost his wife and his children. But maybe it would all come bubbling to the surface when he meets Adam Warlock. And then, speaking of loss, we lost Nebula. She's gone off to find, well, she says to kill Thanos, and I hope that means she's going to be in Infinity War, because I really liked Karen Gillan's performance in Volume 2. So I'm very excited for her to see what her character does next, not only in Infinity War, but I hope she returns for Volume 3. And I would love to see her join the team, quite frankly. She's like basically their Loki now, their anti-hero, right? And then finally, the very first version of the Guardians of the Galaxy was teased, you know, the team that Yondu was on at the very end of the film. So the question is, will they return in Volume 3? I think they should return. I mean, it's an amazing lineup of characters and actors, but I think because of the actors that are involved, they're not going to commit for supporting roles. I think they would commit for like a really kick-ass cameo, like maybe an action cameo if we're lucky. That would be fantastic. Here they just were introduced, then we can see them come in to save the day maybe in one sequence, and then they'll go away. Because I think that's really all that you could get, again, from that group of actors. But it would be worth it. I would love it. So that's where I think that Volume 3 is likely headed based on what we have seen so far and what's been teased. I'm curious, what do you think? Excited? Nervous? And do you think James Gunn can pull off a Jesus Christ superhero? Space Jesus! Do you like the idea of Space Jesus as much as I do? Do you think it's offensive? I mean, I would be a little bit nervous about that. But I think there's so much Jesus Christ imagery in art that I think that you could definitely find a way to do it. I have faith in James Gunn's ability to handle religion, which I guess that's the conclusion. Volume three will be about religion. That would be really interesting in a Marvel movie. All right, write your thoughts down below, and you can check out some more videos right now.